that'll be pumps.
I'm just going about a funeral.
People believe in half-life place, but for me, I think I've got to have the experience.
A friend of a friend introduced me to a guy called Christian, who had made comes from a non-religious background, but made the conscious decision to become a Christian. Christian's a fourth year student at Leeds, and basically Christian lives in a sort of a normal student house, but with a massive difference. He basically lives with four other guys, and they live a completely shared life in terms of money, clothes.
Door.
Oh, someone made the beds.
That's a nice feeling when you get home and someone's made your stripped your sheets and made your beds and vacuum tidied by the looks of it. So this is where we sleep. Christian on top, Ben underneath. And then the other one, we've got Rory up top and me down below. Cupboard system works. So originally the cupboards we did, so this was suits, trousers,
and
shirts.
You all share?
We all share all our clothes. It's quite nice that we're pretty much the same size.
Yeah, I was going to say, lucky none of you are...
Yeah, so Luke's...
It's a bit unfortunate if one of you is a very big guy.
Luke's a bit too tall.
Yeah.
And Christian's a bit too skinny. but yeah, mostly the same size, so... I guess if we look in here, like, so this was my shirt, and then I think this is Ben's, and
so, like, is that a focus of it, that there's no personal property in terms of, like, clothing? How far does that reach to, like, I mean, things like laptops and stuff like that?
So laptops, if you want to use the laptops, the password is bunk beds, or we don't have passwords. So yeah, laptops share. So there's this verse in Acts, which is book in the Bible. And it's talking about the early church, and it says all the believers had everything in common together, and there was no needy persons among them. And so that's part of what we wanted to hear was, we what we have is each other's, like, it's all been given to us, it's all a gift to us, and so we're like, oh, why not share it with each other?
So what would happen, say, because you're all university students, when you go home for the holidays, do you just divvy it out equally, or?
Well, yeah, you better best to be first to leave, otherwise you're nice to share. this is our prayer room. So there's a lot of stuff on the walls, which is people that we're praying for. So this is my family. It's my mum and my dad, and then this is, you know, I guess we people that we're trying to remember in our prayers.
Is everyone that's on the wall also sort of a Christian themselves, or do you also pray for people that don't hold your beliefs?
Yeah, no, very much. There'll be some of our friends and stuff that we don't know, and we get you're praying for them that they're,
And that one there says homeless. Are they the homeless people you've had to stay?
Yeah, so some of them, for homeless friends and sort of guys that sort of live around and that we know.
Yeah.
Okay. Homeless and
That evening, Theo invited us to the Mosaic Church, where his group meet up every week to worship.
Faith amongst us. Lord, for those of us here who are scared to receive the Holy Spirit, to say, yes, I want to be pickled and dunked and soaked and marinated in you, but they don't know what it's going to feel like, I pray for courage and boldness to trust in a good God who wants to bless us. Pray, Holy Spirit, would you fill every heart who's saying that now? Saying, yes, I'm scared, but I want more of you. Holy Spirit, would you come on them in power? Pray, would they know a tangible sense of joy and freedom? Would they feel you touch them? Come in power, Holy Spirit. Those of us who even right now are cynical, even right now our hearts say, this isn't real, this is a new God, I'm scared, or oh, this isn't real.
The next morning, we visited the student house as the group prepared for their community outreach activities under the title The June Project.
How do you go about applying?
There's like an online application. It's open to anyone. So you just kind of like...
Is that how you got it as well?
Yeah, I just applied and said I wanted to help. Like, I know the guys anyway.
What skills did you say you'd bring to it?
I said that I bring passion for worship, so I love to just... Like, you know how in football teams people go crazy over their team, they're like, and they like sing, chant, and like just go crazy. Like,
yeah,
I go crazy over God. So I like sing for God and I like dance for God, and just because I like seen God and met with Him and love Him and
physically seen.
Not physically seen Him, like I've seen like what God's done, I've seen like God working in my life, and like, so I've seen like the ramifications of God.
The June Project is created and run by the group of Christians and is a team effort to clean up the neighbourhood, give food to the homeless and spread the word of
right,
God.
So you're going to give some soup to the homeless people?
For the start of June Project, we're hanging out at the church and we had some lunch afterwards, but surplus soup, so I just passed the guys on the way back.
I don't want to take your time out to help anybody that's homeless or anybody that's having a hard time, but you know what I mean?
Yeah. So,
sometimes when you're down,
and it's great, you know what I mean?
You're just in the world there and it's pissing down at that. Spirits.
I joined some of the group in the park as the sun set, and I used it as an opportunity to chat to some of them.
What's treasure hunting then?
So basically treasure hunting is where we ask God for treasures, and so in the morning, this morning we prayed, God will you give us pictures, visions, words, of people that you want us to meet and people you want us to talk to today. During that time, there was another picture of, it's the name Anna, which is my name, but we didn't think it was me, we just thought it was somebody else, maybe called Anna, because God also gives names as well. Anna and a lone swing, so just somebody on the swing on their own, or just one swing on its own sort of thing. So then there was a time where I was on my own and I was just walking around, and it was the first time all day I'd seen anybody on a swing on their own. And I was walking past and I was like, God, I'm not in my team at the moment, I don't think I should go and talk to them. Just kind of wimping out basically. And God was like, no, when I said Anna, I meant you, Anna. And I was like, okay. So I went and I was like, okay, God.
God right. Said that to you?
Yeah.
One of the group was Rory, who had travelled around the world in search of spirituality and reason.
For someone like me, would you say that to believe in God, I couldn't because of just, you know, what you guys tell me, I'd have to experience it, something like you experienced myself, in order to truly believe?
I think so. People believe and have blind faith, but for me, I think you've got to have the experience.
Yeah.
You know, and really, actually, a lot of religious people get involved in arguments with atheists, and I think that's ridiculous, because an atheist will say you can't prove God, and I'll say, yeah, you can't. I can't prove it to you. I can't just touch you and some magic will happen. You have to have the, to me, you have to have the experience, yeah. And then once you've had the experience, you don't need any proof.
As I returned to the student house, the construction of the prayer room was taking place in order for worship later that evening. Some of the girls in the prayer room were experiencing difficulty in getting a bouncy castle for the culmination of June project. They're excited to tell me how a good Samaritan had intervened.
It was like, we were just chatting with him, he was like, oh, I really want to give back, and like, you know, you're giving so much, can we give you something? Do you need a bouncy castle? Like,
actually, we do need a bouncy castle.
And he was like, oh great, okay, I'll get the bouncy castle. Do you need a generator? And we were just like, no, we were like, we need a generator, do you have one? And he was like, yeah, I've got a generator, da da da. And we're like, oh okay, well, technically we're going to have two generators. And he was like, I've got two generators.
Do you think that was God intervening, getting you those stuff?
Yeah. there's literally like no way that like all of this has come together.
Is there no way that that could be a coincidence?
Well, it was a coincidence. That's what I was thinking. But I like, just because we've been praying about it, and like, you know, really like, we're just like, okay, we really need a bouncy castle. Because I was like,
we can't like afford to get a bouncy castle.
Yeah.
Later that evening, I returned to the prayer room as group worship was about to begin.
This is just half the story. We know that it is sweet indeed to be in your presence.
I kind of feel like I'm welling up a bit now. I don't really know why. But I don't know. I guess I went through a range of emotions. I felt sort of, I felt uneasy,
yeah.
But that's because I think it was such a foreign environment to
yeah,
me.
Yeah.
And then
that's what I was going to say tonight.
Yeah, yeah. I also felt sort of guilty because I felt that that's obviously quite a personal, private thing, and I thought that I was sort of invading.
Okay.
And I also felt sort of pangs of guilt because when you see someone that believes in something, you know, so like full on and totally, and you don't yourself,
yeah,
makes you kind of question yourself.
Yeah.
Kind of hard to explain, you know, it's just, but like, yeah, that was, I felt a whole, every few seconds I was feeling something different.
Yeah.
It's like you're in a,
yeah. Which kind of, so I guess the first thing to say is like, when
when I guess what we believe is happening here is that that something of God, something of His, we call the Holy Spirit, which is part of God. When that the Christian term, the Christian language, that when the Holy Spirit falls,
yeah,
like stuff like that happens, people feel this like incredible range of emotions. That's why you got people laughing, people crying, people yelling out, probably some giggles going on. People maybe start, you hear sort of this thing Christians call tongues, which is,
yeah,
where they can't speak
in, yeah,
in this sort of a language that we don't know. So people call it the language of angels and stuff like that. And it's,
yeah,
I guess it gets quite messy.
Yeah, man, Rory tapped me. Like, two things happened in there that have made me like, oh, man, I'm wrestling with this, mate. Like, I thought at the beginning of this, I was like, there's no way I'd ever believe in. Mate, it's really starting to affect me. Like, I was in there and Rory was sitting on the floor and he just tapped me and he just whispered to me, like, why don't you try singing along? And I was like, okay, you know, I'm here. I want to be respectful. I want to try and be involved. I was like, okay, like, I'm gonna try and sing along. And I, like, opened my mouth and I was like, the words wouldn't come out. Like, I couldn't do it. I just felt like, I felt shame. Like, I thought if I started singing, that would almost be the biggest disrespect to them, because I can't say that I truly believe in. Curran, the guy who tapped me on the shoulder yesterday and said that he was praying for me, just came out and said, do you mind if we talk over there? I was like, yeah, of course, man. So we went over there and he was holding his Bible. And he was like, I think God told me to come and talk to you. Okay, like, what did he say? And he was just like, sort of, I don't know, really, he was sort of just talking about Jesus and stuff, and like, I don't know, man. I asked him, I was like, what, how do you know that, like,
God told you to come and talk to me?
It's definitely affecting me way more than I thought it would. Like, although I'm open to the idea, I never thought that, like, when I'm away from these guys, I'd like question it myself. And now, like, if I have just like a moment to myself, I'll be like running over in my mind and thinking about it, when I never used to do that before. And yeah, I'm wrestling with this, man. Like, I never thought for a second that I'd be this cut up about it, thinking about things.
As my time with the Christians drew to an end, I went along to the June Project Summer Fete.
I don't know what people have said to you in the past. No doubt many of you have had nice things spoken over you. But some of you have had people say, you're not worth it. You're not loved. Nobody cares. But we're here as Christians to say, actually, you are cared for. You're made by God and He loves you passionately.
With the fate in full swing, I got chatting to a guy called Tom who had some interesting views on science and faith.
The thing is God didn't make us robots. He made us with the potential to disobey Him because He wanted love to be real and trust in Him to be real. And so when we read back in the Garden of Eden story, I say it no apology, there was...
Is that literal, the Garden of Eden story?
I believe it is.
Do you reject evolution?
Macroevolution, yes. Microevolution, no. Macroevolution, yep, says what Darwin says, that over millions and millions of eons and stuff like that, species somehow formed, somehow developed, matter became somehow living, somehow formed, somehow evolved, and so your great-great-great-great-great-grandmother is a jellyfish, you know? And I guess I have a little hard time with that. But what people take as gospel in our modern science, a lot of it's never been proven. It's just by academia, the powers that be, they're so entrenched that basically people are indoctrinated about it.
Theo pointed me in the direction of a student called Brad, who had only recently himself become a Christian.
So yeah, it was like I said, first year of uni, typical student.
Yeah.
Oh, getting drunk, doing typical student things. A few things in life happened, I just wasn't happy in the slightest. Christianity just gave us that opportunity where you can accept that, like, everything's alright, you can accept that there's something wrong, you don't have to put on a brave face, you don't have to pretend that things are okay.
We heard in church today that you were really ill yesterday, that you couldn't even stand up, that, you know, an ill man, like you were bedridden.
Yeah, I was a mess yesterday.
And so Christian in church said that, he quoted, I can't remember,
I think quoted a verse. James, if any of you are ill, find your elders, your brothers, confess your sins, ask for prayer, and be anointed with oil, and trust in the name of the Lord. And
So we heard that they came round and they poured oil on your forehead. And what was that experience like?
To be honest, I was really dubious. I didn't expect much from it at all. But
it sounds weird because I know where you're coming from. I myself was a bit unsure as to how well it would work, but the second they did it, like, in a few minutes, I was feeling fine. I was on my feet and I had a shower, get rid of the oil. I was on my feet and I've been fine since.
So you think that was the power of God that healed?
Completely, yeah.
But do you understand that perhaps you yourself 8 months ago would have said that that's completely unfeasible, that's not rational, that's not science, that's not, there's no evidence.
I'm still a chemistry student, I still have logic, I still care about evidence and wanting to know things, but that's never really been an obstacle to me. It's never been an obstacle whereby I've said I can't have faith because I don't know all the answers to the truth. I don't know, I never will. I'm not so, God.
Last night I had an epiphany, as it were, and I was just like, I don't think I can believe in this because there's just not enough answers to the questions I'm looking for. But I feel that as human beings, we are so impressionable that once you immerse yourself in a community like this, as lovely and as kind as you guys are, you lose sight of the fact of the most fundamental question of asking yourself whether God is real, when people just state to you that God, this is what God said, this is what God, and then you get sucked in. And I kind of feel like, I don't know, maybe is that what would have happened to you? Just, there'd have to be more answers. There's too many glaring omissions from the Bible. There's too many things that don't make sense. There's the abandoning of rationality, of pragmatism, of just sort of everything that I've grown up with. And I don't think I could do it. And I've been thinking about that a lot, and I really respect you guys. I think for me, there's two facets. There's the sense of community, there's the sense of selflessness, and there's the great work that you guys do and the way that you live and the fact that you're so content and so sure in your lives. And I find that so appealing. But then on the other side of the fence, there's the fact that accepting that Jesus is God, that the world is 6,000 years old, that creationism happened, and that God is a just God, but then he answers prayers for a bouncy castle but lets children die in Africa. I can't accept that part. I can accept the first part, but I don't think I'll ever be able to accept the second.
Although I had come to a realization that I hadn't found faith, I was invited to church one last time to discuss why I shouldn't give up.
You would change your life style in your bedroom or your living room with a blink of an eye. You choose the way you live. Be accountable to it or change it. If there's anything in the world that you should have most, is to know that the love that he has for you is endless. It's the fastest flowing love river I've ever heard or ever seen.
Quite horrible to say, maybe, in a way, okay. Is that Christianity or any religion is sort of, if you're feeling terrible inside or you're feeling lonely or you have any kind of imperfection, that before, Jesus will take that away from you. Well, the crux of it is, for me, is that I guess I'd like to believe in people, and I think that people can change and better themselves and find that self-esteem which you said you can't walk on. And I'd like to think that people can do that without God, without religion, purely just within a community, finding people
that really
care for you. And that I'd like to think that some people would like to turn their lives around just because, for themselves, you know, for themselves, like a power that comes deep within, that people want to make a change for themselves, to think, yes, I am worth something, and yes, I can change my life around, that I don't need some external divinity.
Before my week was over, I wanted to have one last chat with Theo about the struggle of finding faith.
Do you think you'd still be you without God?
I don't know. So there's times when I've almost walked away. One night, second year, I packed it in. It's weird. Like,
what made you pack it in?
So I started to wrestle a lot with hell, I guess, and the idea of hell. And I didn't like it, and I really struggled to believe in a God that could punish like nice guys for they just didn't believe in him just because they lived in a different part of the world for eternity. I found that really inconsistent with the God I believed in, or thought I believed in. It just didn't fit anymore for me, and it was horrible. I didn't want to be a Christian anymore.
I found it reassuring that Theo questioned God too. And although unlike me, he had overcome his struggle with religion, I promised him I'd keep searching.